All right, so we're down at the shop today, and kind of some new things that'll be happening. The excavator that I bought a year and a half ago, I put it up for sale. And one of the sellers asked for a video if they were going to buy the excavator, you know, to kind of go over it, etc. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do that and kind of just turn that into, if you're buying or selling an excavator, what do you need to look for? And especially on a used machine, my particular machine, it's an older machine, 2005. Served me very well. Really, the only reason I'm getting rid of it is because it's not exactly the size that I need. So that's kind of a hint of something that's about to happen. But I'm just going to go over this machine real quick from the back to the front and show you what to look for. And then we'll actually take it out and do a little bit of operation, kind of show you what to check for. Anyway, stay tuned. It should be a good video. Okay, starting out at the back, this is not a cab machine. This is an open canopy machine. First thing that I would recommend checking, and you know, it depends on the age of the machine. This is a 2005, so obviously the degree of kind of what the machine looks like changes when you get an older machine. This particular machine, it been a 2005, is in really good shape. As you can see on the ROPS, the ROPS is actually in really good shape. Decals are still on it. Really, this machine hasn't really seen anything major as far as the ROPS goes. The only real bend in the whole ROPS is the handle. Something's hit it here, which is real easy to do when you're pulling back the bucket. So starting here at the back, this does have a cast rear, which has definitely, I mean, basically, you're not going to really damage this. This is just one big, you can kind of hear it there, hopefully. One big giant piece of metal. You could pretty much roll that into a tree and it's not going to really do anything. The rest of this machine, tops, sides, everything are fiberglass. Other than a couple of little, you know, scratches, etc. The cab of this machine, considering it's 2005, is in pretty good shape. You know, if this was a newer machine, like within the last 5 years, this would be concerning. You know, all basically on this machine, all the locks, and this has a catch, so this is where all your fuel stuff's at. These locks mount in here. At some point, some owner somewhere probably lost the key and they basically popped out all the locks. Going around on this same piece, obviously we've had lots of impacts here on the front. This is pretty typical of just about every one of these John Deere's I've seen. This typically is crushed in little ways. If you watch my previous videos, the battery is here. There's about that much space between where this has been in the battery, so that really isn't an issue. This is steel, so if you wanted to fix this, it would be fairly easy. You just basically take a weld on some studs and take a slide hammer and pound that back out. It wasn't super important to me. This is fairly easy to get to because this is directly, this panel right here comes off really easily because the battery's right here. On this side, we've had some impacts. This is all metal, big paint flake off here. Like I say, I really haven't damaged this of me owning it, but whoever had it before, you know, it has had some contact. Important things to look for is that you can still get to everything. There's two grease fittings there. One goes back to the cylinder. The other one is actually the swing motor grease point. And that is your auxiliary tool flow control. And what that does is, if you want bidirectional control, like you've got a thumb, you want it bidirectional. If you're running a hammer or something, it's only one direction. You flip that valve and the return side won't go through the control body. Keeps the hydraulics cooler when you're running something constant like a mower or what have you. And that nut there is the same size as that. So I basically just keep a socket that's that size. That way I can swap attachments out with just one tool. Going back to the back of the machine here. A couple things you want to check. This machine's been sitting at least overnight. It did rain, so that is water. But the big thing is if you have engine oil or anything like that, it's typically good going to leak out of the back where the pan's at. This machine is motor-wise doesn't have any leaks. It is an Isuzu engine. Actually, the only thing I think that I could even mention that was a problem back here that you would, you know, maybe want to fix is the clip for the air cleaner's missing. The way I got around it is I basically tie strapped that on. You don't really replace this super often. I know the rear clip's on this one, the front clip's not. It's a Donaldson part. You can get it. It just wasn't something super important to me. But things you'll be looking for are, you know, do you see any leaks? And not that a leak is world-ending. Obviously, if it's around a fitting or something like that, that's really easy to fix. Anything on the top side of the motor leaking is really easy to fix. It's when you start getting down, like, you know, if you start seeing leaks at the head, the oil pan, etc., that gets a little harder to fix. This particular motor, I don't know if the light's going to catch that, but everything's drying here. There's no leaks or problems with the engine itself. And it's relatively clean. As you can see, I mean, there's no magic here. And typically, this is how you want to see a machine if you go get it. You know, you want to see the machine as it's being used, not necessarily just pressure washed. If you get there and they've just pressure washed it, be concerned about leaks, etc. You'll want to run that machine a little bit and see if you can see any leaks anywhere. And, you know, make sure all your panels work. Again, it's not a showstopper that they don't. It's just you need to be able to know that you can fix it. Because the worst thing that could happen is you're operating the machine and one of these fly open while you're close to trees. And you end up doing more damage than is already there. This particular machine, all the holes work. Everything latches the way it's supposed to. It's got a little latch thing here. Another thing to check, coolant. We've got good coolant level. This machine's never given me any coolant issues, but I do recommend that you do check it. Because that's one sign of like blown head gasket, etc. If you've got like coolant that's blowing out, etc. Or low coolant, it's got to go somewhere. So it's either coming out the tailpipe, or back pressure will actually blow it back into the coolant tank, or pop the radiator. So this particular machine, all your oil cooler, everything's right here where you can get to it. So what you want to look for here is, does the machine have the correct level of fluid? This machine is dead cold, and that's about where it should be. Dead cold, and a lot has to do with the boom position, which it's not exactly in the check oil boom position. But you want to see some oil here. A lot of times you can actually see the quality of the oil. This is fresh and new. I think this oil may be a few months old, so that looks good. And basically the result of that is your filter is here. There's also another bag filter in that, and that's just replaced. As you can see, that filter right there, you have to drain the entire tank and replace the fluid to change it. So your main hydraulic lines are here. This is the switch to backhoe excavator. One thing I'll mention about this that took me a little while: when you change this, it will actually overextend. So you can feel there's a dent in there, but you can actually, if you just push, keep pushing and go past that, that only one side of the controls will work. So you kind of want it to be lined up on here. So if you're buying a used machine, be sure that you ask. You can feel the dent in. So this has both backhoe and excavator mode. So that's in excavator mode now. Whoever had this immediately before me had already done a lot of work in replacing a lot of the hoses. This hose is new. You know, no leaks in the pilot lines. The only issue that I've seen is there is a return hose, and I'm not sure the camera is going to catch it. But this hose here actually goes to this piece, and there's another little piece of rubber. But I can start seeing just a couple of cracks, and where the cracks are at. So as you can see, this is pressure. This is a return hose, so they're just hose clamps holding it on. So it's like much like a radiator hose. The very top of the hose in a couple places is kind of, you know, starting to crack. It'll probably last a really long time. This is a standard size hose. So at some point, that little section, it's only about 3 inches long, will need to be replaced. That's something to take in, take in mind. If you do buy an older machine, a lot of times it won't be like hoses damaged from use. Sometimes they just get damaged from age, but from what I can tell, everything in this machine, other than that little short hose, has been replaced and new. One thing I like about the John Deere, all these are quick disconnects. So if you did have to work on something here, basically this whole assembly, once you unscrew it here, this will actually, once this is gone, this whole assembly will swing up and out of the way and you can get to all that there. And if you need to, you can actually remove this entirely. All these are quick connects. You don't need tools. You just kind of push on the fitting. It's like a quick coupler fitting and they come off and they're all labeled, as you can see. So you can tell where they go back to. So they've kind of designed this where it's fairly easy to work on. You know, another thing to check, how the electronics look. This is the bulk of the wiring for this excavator. There's a little bit with the fuse box, but that's one thing that I looked at when I bought this excavator. What did this look like? Had it been cut into a lot? This is all still factory connections, wiring, even the tape, everything's factory. This, I think, is the timer for the glow plugs. And I know they sell these on eBay, but this one hasn't given me any problems and it's been well taken care of. This may be a good example. So there's a little short hose just like this one when I was mentioning the hose. You can kind of see how that's cracking there. So over a period of time, and typically a machine like this is going to leak. I would say that this one barely leaks hydraulic fluid, and it's coming from the return lines, mainly from the one that's lower, and it's just a seat. So basically this machine takes 46 hydraulic fluid. So maybe once every 6 months I have to put, a quart of oil in it because it leaks down the pan. And then every once in a while you can see just a little bit dripping out. Let me see if we've got any. So that's another thing to look at when you're looking at the excavator. If it's been sitting, look at the tracks. So here we don't really see any leaks. That's an old spill on the concrete, and then we had the water back here, but typically you'll see something on the tracks. And usually this one will at least wet a track. So there we go, right there. So basically that leak all the way on the other side from that return hose, just gradually, it actually builds up in this pan. And as you're moving, sometimes it'll look like it's a giant leak if the machine's been sitting for a long time. Like if I let it sit for 2 or 3 weeks, all of a sudden I'm moving the machine and there may be like, less than a pint just all of a sudden kind of drip out. That's just barely dripping, but that's coming from that return hose. So that's one thing to look for. If you see a track and there's fluid pouring out when the machine hadn't been moved, that's probably something you're going to have to address immediately. If you see something like that, that's probably just like an old return hose, a slight leak, maybe an O-ring if you've got O-ring style hydraulic connections, maybe some seeping out. Not something you got to fix immediately. It may be something you want to fix, when you have time. Or you can just keep putting a little bit of hydraulic fluid. This particular machine, I don't worry about it because it's not leaking fast enough. A pint, a quart every year isn't something worth pulling all of this back off just to fix that one thing. So up here, I've kind of already went over that valve. Another thing to check is these are probably the worst. It's not a big cost issue, but it's a big labor issue, is these hoses. As you can see, these are all new with a high quality hose. So these will last a really long time. But this is the number one place that I've, somewhere on the boom, where you have to replace hydraulic hoses. Those up there, not a problem. You just run to Napa and get a new one. These take a lot longer because they actually need to go down under and they end up in this cab. On this particular machine, there's a plate that comes out here. If that's not big enough, you can actually remove the seat and you can get even more access. But typically everything you can get to from that plate. That's underneath this pad. I don't know if you'll be able to see it, but It basically goes right here. A lot of people have asked in the videos, what is this thing? This is your two-speed. So you mash that with your heel while you're moving these, and that makes your two-speed work, makes your track faster. So some things to check here. A lot of people get real concerned with this cylinder. Very rarely do you ever see any wear on this cylinder because most people are not swinging the boom much. This machine, I would say it's probably as new. In other words, there's no wear in this bushing, no wear in that rear bushing. The swing bushings are really, really tight. And they're basically, the grease fitting on those are basically on the other side in this area and the same position there. But this particular machine really hasn't seen in its life a lot of, boom pivoting. I've used it quite a bit, but typically I pivot the boom and then I never move it again. Because it is a zero turn machine, you can dig up right next to a house. Here on the boom, basically what you're looking for is any kind of super big damage. This one's only just got paint scratches. This has been taken good care of or replaced since I've purchased it. This is in good shape. The boom's sitting on there. A lot of times you can just come up if everything's kind of slack and you can shake the boom and there's zero movement there. We hear a little bit of slack probably up in this area. You can kind of see there. And for the hours that are on this machine and the age, that's not bad. And you can probably put several thousand hours before you actually need to replace the pin. Typically the pin will wear before the bushing will. I do recommend replacing bushings when you replace the pin, but you don't necessarily have to. This particular machine's in pretty good shape. Really the only problem that I've seen or had, this pin here when I first got it before I got the thumb, this was the big wear point. So this pin that came through here, so when I put the thumb on, I got a new pin, put new bushings in the dipper stick, and that pretty much tightened this up to an acceptable level. And if you watch my last video, I replaced this. Did not replace this pin. It's wore, but it's not wore bad enough to worry about replacing anything yet. Another thing to check too, as you can see, look in this area, just to make sure that the seal's in decent shape. This one's brand new packed. This has been in there for probably 2 or 3 months now, and completely sealed up, no leaks. But typically if your rod is good, and you just need to repack a seal, if you go to John Deere, it's going to be pretty expensive to order a seal kit from them. If you go online and search for your machine model, I picked up a seal kit for this entire cylinder for $30. And it's basically the same seals or quality seals that, John Deere or anybody else would do. So I would highly recommend, don't assume that, if you've got a leaking cylinder, what usually happens and what happened on this machine is the wiper itself had just got rotten. And that started letting anything that was leaking down here in the gland start coming out here. And you can just basically repack the whole cylinder for $30 and maybe an hour's worth of time. So that to me isn't a huge deal. All the other seals on this machine are in good shape. This one's good. It's intact. Same kind of story here. This one's probably a little newer. Somebody probably repacked it before I got it. So that one's in good shape. Like I said, the thumb is basically new. So this cylinder came new. And this is weld on. If you want to watch the video of me installing this, I've got this on YouTube. But that is installed to Showtime Manufacturing specifications. And the main thing they want you not to do, don't weld up here. They want you to weld up and down on the boom, but don't weld across on the boom. It will change the strength of the boom. And this, welding this way really doesn't affect it. If anything, it probably makes it stronger. Is auxiliary hydraulics. I know on the Wacker Nuisance and several other manufacturers, this isn't standard. And even if they have the connections, a lot of times you can maybe only do a thumb or maybe only do a hammer, which are two different operation styles. That's what that valve is up front. That valve is for setting these up to where your return is going directly into the tank or going through the control body. In other words, two directions versus one direction. This particular machine, and what I highly recommend you do, because I can't really recommend to anybody to buy an excavator without a thumb. But there are a lot of them out there on the market, especially the used market. Make sure you get one with a thumb, and make sure it has both operation modes. So on the boom too, this machine doesn't have really any issues. But what you'd be looking for is like cracks in the boom. You don't really see it as much with these minis. But what you want to look for is like make sure all the welds are good. You know, basically just inspect all the way up and down the boom, especially the back side of this boom coming up. You'd want to look as close as you can to make sure you don't have any crack. Like I say, you really don't have the issue with the minis. The bigger excavators, usually where I've had an issue is right here. Somewhere right along in here, it'll want to crack. Another thing to check for is grease fittings. If you saw when I first got this, that one was missing. That's been replaced. Those are super important. You can't really service the machine without it. All the other grease fittings on this machine are functional and working. And it's got several different styles. You've got an embedded one here. You got an exposed one here. A lot of it just depends on the location. Same kind of style here. You've got one here. All of the pins on this machine, and most new modern machines now, have the grease through pin. So basically you actually put the grease nipple into that hole and there's a grease fitting in there. And that's pretty much the same. Even the thumb that I bought has that same style. So buckets. This bucket, I think it had been a retooth, so it's fairly, you know, the teeth are in decent shape. Side cutters are in great shape. You saw one of my last videos, the bottom was bent a little bit. So we replaced the bottom in this bucket. And that basically makes it where it makes a really smooth bottom. This bucket works great now. That's just something to keep in mind. Not that buckets are a huge deal. A lot of people think that a bucket is something you would buy with an excavator and it should last forever. They don't. They're consumable. And they're relatively inexpensive compared to the rest of the machine. This has a wedge lock connector on it. So basically you got a bolt here that squeezes this wedge, pinches it here. And these are readily available. You can order these buckets all day long. Anywhere between $500 and $1,300, depending on what size you want, what options you want. So that, you know, and relative to the machine, the bucket isn't a super big consideration. Moving on to here, you kind of want to, you know, check where when I bought this machine, this cutting edge was not there. There was a small, really small one. It was probably stopped about right there. And what it does is it rubs the bottom of this frog. So when it got that low, before it actually ate through this frog, I basically put a new cutting edge. There's kind of a shot there of how it works. So you've got joints back there, joints here. The pins are probably wore just a little bit on this. There is a little bit of slop, but to me that really doesn't affect it. The angle of the blade is such that if you're back blading, it really doesn't affect anything. And if you're forward blading, this is steep enough to where it's actually engaging the ground and not causing a problem. You're not getting like washboarding or anything like that. So starting at the top, we have everything. So that's what I was saying about this bin. For the age of this unit, it's in really good shape. You got all the decals still, tells you your lift capacities. If you go back here, all your routine maintenance, basically your instruction manual is right here. All your fluid tops, lubrication points, times, everything right here behind you. A bunch of, you know, keep it right side up kind of information. Wear your seat belt. That doesn't even look like an excavator. That's pretty funny. Operator side, I do like this machine. It has nice foot pedals, probably the nicest foot pedals of any machine that I've owned. They don't flip, they're solid, and they just work. This particular machine, auxiliary hydraulics are here. So when adding the or running the mower, it's in one direction, so this is the only direction it works. When you're in thumb mode, you can thumb out, thumb in, either way, and then your boom swing, swing the boom this way, swing the boom this way, right here. Joystick's fairly simple on this machine. I think there was a horn button at one point. It's right here. It doesn't work anymore. The horn does work. This does not, so there's some, either this switch is bad or something's wrong with the wiring that goes down in there. Again, that wasn't a huge big deal to me. On one of my previous videos, I was mentioning that the pilot switch didn't work, and what that was is when you put this down, this little piece here hits a switch down there and turns on the pilot hydraulics. I've since fixed that. It was just out of adjustment. This is a display that doesn't work. I've taken this apart several times. There's some components that are really hard to find, or they don't make anymore, and you really need a schematic to actually do the repair. There's a transistor that's blown completely off of the display. I'm confident that the display and the microcontroller and everything work. It's just that it won't actually turn the thing on because the transistor's blown off. So you really need a schematic of this, or completely reverse engineer this to repair it. It could be done. Not something I was super interested in. This machine will run all day long on fuel. It does have cutoffs for the engine. You know, if you had low oil pressure or whatever, it's going to turn off the engine anyway. So basically, this is an alternator. And then, you know, the engine is not running warning. There is also a coolant light here. This switch, to my knowledge, doesn't do anything. This was like on different models. This turns on the work light, which the work light's way down there. And there may have been one at some point on that little stub right there. It was gone by the time I got the machine. That one there does work. It's a ground system. So basically, if you ground it out, it turns on a relay. I can hear it click and it turns on that front work light. But because this is disabled, that doesn't work. Over here on this side, you've got your normal John Deere key. Takes a John Deere key like so. This is the all the backup alarms and everything function on this machine. This is supposed to disable it while you're moving until you stop and go again. This doesn't work and hasn't worked since I got it. This is the throttle, brand new throttle cable. If you want to watch the video on that, it does have a cigarette lighter. The hole's here. I just have never remounted that. I've never used it. Apparently, it does have power. Just takes some bolts. You can kind of see what it looks like here. Kind of mounts something like that. If somebody needed that or felt that was important, seat belts are intact and working. This is where, back here, there's actually a panel. You can take this off and you'll be able to get to the alternator. So that's something important to look at. You know, how would I work on something if I had to?
But
so that's basically the machine. The machine's cold right now. I'm going to restart the video here in a second, and we're going to fire the machine up after I open up the garage door, and we'll go out and do some
digging. Sometimes I'll crank this, and the key will come back out after you crank it.
We don't have anything nefarious blowing out the exhaust. We put our control down. Now we're just going to pick up on the boom. Make sure our blade's up. Get squared up to the machine here. And we're going to go into two-speed mode. Back up a little ways. So I'm going to get off, go around and set the camera up somewhere. One thing I'll mention, if you hear that squeaking that's coming from right here, That is the belt slipping, and that goes away once the thermostat opens and it runs. If you wanted to fix that, you could probably replace the belt. One time I thought it was a water pump and basically disassembled a bunch of that, and the water pump was fine. But just something to note when you crank up a machine, you know, what is the actual issue? Is it repairable? Is it a big issue? This has always done this since I bought it and has not been an issue. I'm setting up the camera now, but you can hear that squeaking just suddenly stopped as soon as that thermostat opened. We did a little digging, pretty much. Hydraulics are really strong. Picked the machine up no problem. You go back to different zoom level here. Motor's in good shape. Big thing to check for is, you know, blow by gas. And the easiest way to check, you'll have some blow by. See there, that cap's not shooting off. There's not a lot of gas coming out through the crankcase. Which basically means you've got good seals around your pistons. Nothing's blowing by, pushing up into the crankcase. As you can see there, no like oil or anything coming out of there. Good smooth running engine. It's got a lot of life left in it. You can see there, even though we just ran just a little bit, we're up to the center, so our hydraulic fluid's at a normal level. But just give it a good look over. It helps a lot to just take a look, you know, after the machine's moved a little bit, just to see if you might have a problem somewhere on the machine. No fluids are squirting out. We don't have any additional fluid running out anywhere along the tracks. Tracks are nice and clean. We don't see any additional fluid leaking out. I'm going to turn the unit off now and show you what you should look at on the undercarriage. Okay, so on the undercarriage, you know, obviously tracks. These are not new, obviously, but I would say they're probably anywhere between 30 and 50% still good, which is decent. Most of the undercarriage on this, you see my other videos, the rollers, front idlers have been replaced. When I first bought it, the very first thing I bought for it were these rollers. These rollers, whoever I purchased it from, they had actually painted all this gray and already replaced all of these bottom rollers. So pretty much everything's new. It's got a newer sprocket on it. The drives are in good shape. If you watch one of my previous videos, if the seller will let you, if you could just inspect that oil. This particular one, if you look at my previous video from just a few months ago, you can see where I drained that oil out and put new oil in, and the oil looked good. That'll give you a lot of information about what status your drive motors are in. If you've got a swing problem, you'll notice it when you start swinging. Like if you noticed, I got a, you know, few hundred pounds in a bucket, that little piece of concrete swung around. You'll be able to feel that in the machine or hear it. This machine doesn't have any issues with the swing. One thing to check, and one thing I do recommend, maybe once a year, if you can inspect these, if the seller will let you prior, but if you take off this panel, you can see the back of the swing motors. You can get the model number and etc. on this one. This one's, I believe these are Nietzsche drive motors. But that helps a lot with being able to determine the condition. And these hoses are fairly hard to replace. Not in this particular unit, because they pretty much go straight up and come right through that access panel. But the hoses to the drive motors probably get the most abuse other than the boom. Okay, hopefully this footage helps the seller that's looking at this, and also helps anyone that's looking at either buying or selling one of these older mini excavators out in their purchase decision and what to expect. When I purchased this, I fully expected it was a 2005. It has, these machines can go 8,000-9,000 hours pretty easily with proper maintenance. But given that it's probably in the middle of that range, I came to expect that I was going to have to do a little work on it. Probably the throttle cable was probably the worst. It was the least expensive. It was only like $130, but it took almost all day to replace just something as simple as a throttle cable. So whoever's buying, ends up purchasing this machine, you're welcome. The throttle cable's been replaced, and that's probably, in my opinion, I think I probably could have had the motor out quicker than that throttle cable. So that's been done. So that's basically it for the video. Hopefully this helps you out. If you have any other suggestions or anything you want to add to the video or any questions, please leave a comment. And don't forget to like and subscribe. We've got some, obviously some new stuff coming. Thanks.